Let's get some analysis. I'd like to bring in Mykola Trofimenko. He is the rector for the Mariupol State University. He is also a member of the city council there and was forced to flee recently because of the fighting. He joins us now from Lviv. Mykola, welcome to the show. It's good to have you on. I want to start off by asking you when you left Mariupol and how the escape route was like for you.
We fled out with my family on March 15, and we managed to get to Berdyansk on this day. And we started and continued the way to Zaporizhia on March 16. And actually, when we understood that the city and our neighborhood is totally devastated, that it was very, very much dangerous to keep my five years old son and wife in the basement, in the shelter, we decided to get out of the city with a column of cars that was headed by the International Red Cross organization. Actually, we hadn't any humanitarian corridors. It was our choice to check the way the 160 cars on March 14 managed to find through the minefields outside the city using some suburban roads. And actually, they succeeded, and the same we did, actually.
Yeah. I mean, I'm going to get to the humanitarian corridors in just a bit, but the route that you took from Mariupol to Berdyansk to Zaporizhzhia is pretty much the same route that the buses belonging to the Red Cross are trying to utilize as we speak. We know that there's at least one functioning cell phone tower in Mariupol. Are you in contact with anyone there? What are they saying?
There was one functioning cell tower. Unfortunately, now we don't have any connection with all the seashore villages and the city of Mariupol, because Russians, they turned these cell towers off, and they are giving people their SIM cards of so-called company Phoenix, of their own cell company. And they turned off all possible connection. Actually, we were in the same situation from March 2 till March 16. We didn't have any sources of information from the outside world, any connection with our relatives or with our friends. And just in a couple of spots in the city, we were able to find the connection to speak to our relatives, actually. Mm-hmm. And as you can see, the city is totally devastated. Yeah. It's really the modern genocide, and what we're facing now, it's a deportation, actually. When, you know, during the World War II, the Nazis, they were taken from Ukraine, our black soil, that is very rare, okay. And 80% of these soils are in Ukraine, and now they're trying to get people from Ukraine.
Because I don't have a lot of time left, I want to ask you one final question briefly. I mean, there are reports that Russia has been forcibly relocating thousands of civilians to Russia, or at least Russian-controlled areas. Have you witnessed any of that from Mariupol?
I have a lot of friends, colleagues that were forced to get to the as they are calling them, the camps for the filtration of people, where they checking the connection of our citizens to the armed forces of Ukraine, where they force people to sign some documents that they are blaming mm-hmm. nationalists and for some bombings of Mariupol. So they're preparing some cases, okay. Criminal cases, I think. And they take these people to the regions of Russia with no possibility to leave these regions. They're taking the Ukrainian documents and giving some papers that these people are IDPs and they have to live in these regions for 2 years, actually.
Okay.
So it's a really, really deportation. Okay. And then,
it's genocide. A fascinating story, and I do thank you for joining us here on TRT World. I do appreciate the your story and the analysis. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.